Most loving, righteous Heavenly Father, we are so honored and grateful that you've allowed us to come here today to worship the true and living God. And we thank you, Lord, for all the blessings that are ours to enjoy every day. We ask, Lord, that you continue to bless us as we spend time good and faithful. We thank you for this congregation and all the ones that meet here. And we ask your continued blessings on each and every one. We have a special prayer tonight for Marty Thomas, and that she be with her and bring her back to her once more to help. Be with the doctors and nurses that are attending to her, Lord. We pray that she'll be back in our fold very soon. We pray, Lord, that you'll be with any visitors that might be with her tonight, and you'll give them a safe destination to their next journey. We pray, Lord, that you'll be with all the others that are attending to be sick. You'll heal them, and watch over them, and be with the caretakers. We pray, Lord, that you watch over the leadership of this congregation, the leadership of this country, and that you'll be with them, and that the Holy Spirit may sink deep within their heart, Lord, and they'll make godly decisions that will glorify thee, and that will be a godly nation. Thank you, Lord, for all the young ones here that are going to continue on with your word and your statutes, and there will be many more generations of godly people in this country and in this city. We thank you, Lord, most of all, for thy son, Jesus. We beg for forgiveness through him. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'd like to mark the book, your books, 332, the Son of Invitation, or 332, the after lesson. 473 will be singing this time. It's convenient. Let's stand. Sing 473.
Saint in the arms of Jesus. Thank you.
says on the screen behind me, tonight is the first Sunday night of the month, and so we're going to be having questions and answers tonight. And I hope you brought your Bibles with you. You may want to get them out as we look at one question this evening that was submitted. Normally I try to do two questions, but this particular question is fairly well involved, and includes a lot of discussion about sort of some contemporary political matters, and so I wanted to give it the appropriate time to answer it thoroughly. But the question, as it was submitted to me, is this: who is the rightful owner of the state of Israel? Now that's a pretty good question, isn't it? And of course that has some things to do with current political things also. Let me just remind you before we get started that every first Sunday of the month we have question and answer night, and there is a box in the foyer. If you would like to submit a question to that box, feel free to do that. I receive those questions and then I put them in a file, and then I go through every Sunday, first Sunday of the month, and select one or two out of there and try to answer those questions. And I think I've answered all of the ones that were submitted, most of the ones that have been submitted. And I've just got a few left. So go ahead and if you have a Bible question or something comes up in Bible class that we're discussing, go ahead and put that in the question box. And you can also use that box. I think it says suggestions on it. You can also use that as a feedback for any of the sermons or any Bible class lessons. If you would like to have a Bible class lesson or sermon on a particular topic, then please go ahead and suggest that as well, and you're feel free to put that in that box also. All right, well, let's get to the question this evening, and the question is, as we stated earlier, who is the rightful owner of the state of Israel? Now, I'm going to assume that this is a Bible question and not just a political question, because I think that what the questioner has in mind is, what does the Bible say about the rightful owner of the state of Israel? And that's how I'm going to pursue it this evening. Well, first of all, let me say this. If there are many religious bodies in the world today that declare unconditionally that God gave the land of Canaan to the children of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob also is named Israel, all right, that God gave it to that group of people in perpetuity unconditionally. That's the key word, unconditionally. Is it the case that God gave that land to that body of people unconditionally? Or did he put conditions on their remaining in the land, and that land being theirs continually? Well, one of the passages that they use to argue for this, those who believe this in the religious world today, comes from Genesis chapter 13 and verses 14 and 15. Genesis chapter 13 and verses 14 and 15. And this particular passage is, of course, key to understanding God's promise, and especially to Abraham here. He reiterated this promise to Isaac and Jacob as well later on. But in these verses, it says this, Genesis chapter 13, in verses 14 and 15. And the Lord said to Abram, after Lot had separated from him, lift your eyes now and look from the place where you are, northward, southward, eastward, and westward. For all the land which you see, I give to you and your descendants forever. And there's that little word forever on the end of that verse. And so some take this verse and they say, you see, God gave it to the descendants of Abraham forever. And so they continue to have right to that land today is what some people argue. Well, the question though is whether or not this was a condition conditional statement, whether God put conditional conditions on this particular statement. And we're going to see that he actually did later on. As we mentioned, the promise was made to Isaac in Genesis 26 and verse 4, and also to Jacob in Genesis 35 verse 12. So this is a significant promise. The land promise is often called in, as we study the Bible, this is often called the land promise to Abraham. Now, if such a promise were an unconditional promise, then there would be a biblical case for Abraham's descendants to have possession of that land. But was it unconditional? The fact is that it was not unconditional. There are other Bible passages that discuss this conditions that are associated with this land promise. Look at, for example, Leviticus chapter 18 and verses 26 to 28. Leviticus chapter 18 and verses 26 through 28. This is God speaking to the children of Israel, and he says, he's talking about all these statutes that he's given them regarding moral issues, and he says in verse 26, "You shall therefore keep my statutes and my judgments, and shall not commit any of these abominations, either any of your own nation or any stranger who dwells among you. For all these abominations the men of the land have done who were before you. And thus the land is defiled." Now notice verse 28. And this is a continuation of what he says in verse 26. He says, "Lest the land vomit you out also when you defile it, as it vomited out the nations that were before you." And so what God is saying here is this, that your continued possession of the land that you are going to inherit depends upon whether or not you remain a moral people and a people who are faithful to the Lord. And if you do not remain a moral people, then just as those who are in the land before you, that land vomited them out, that is, because of their immorality, they were then expelled from the land. God is saying, so also, if you become immoral, you're going to be expelled from that land as well. And so there are some conditions on the promise that God made regarding possession of the land. Now, another passage to take into consideration is found in Deuteronomy chapter 29 and verse 24 through 28, which is another passage. Well, let's look at Deuteronomy chapter 28 first. Now, you've got to remember the context of the book of Deuteronomy here as well. This is Moses' speech to those children of Israel who survived the wandering of the wilderness, right? They had been condemned to wander the wilderness for 40 years because of the rejection of God's command to go to the land and take it. And now it's their descendants, those who were 20 years old and younger, are there to, they've grown up in that 40 years, and now they're going to inherit the land. And so Moses is speaking to them, and he's telling them how to behave when they enter into God's promised land. Now, that's the book of Deuteronomy. Now, in chapter 28 and verse 64, notice what it says. Chapter 28, verse 64. That if they don't behave themselves, if they don't continue to make a moral people, and people who obey the voice of the Lord, it says this, verse 64. "Then the Lord will scatter you among all peoples from one end of the earth to the other. And there you shall serve other gods, which neither you nor your fathers have known, wood and stone. And among these," 65 says, "among these nations you shall find no rest, nor shall the sole of your foot have a resting place. But there the Lord will give you a trembling heart various conditions placed upon them remaining in the land. If they're not faithful to the Lord, if they don't obey the Lord's commands, if they become immoral, then God is going to deliver them over to another nation, and they will not have any rest. They will be wanderers. They'll be scattered. And that's what God says here in Deuteronomy 28 and verses 64 and 65. Now, look at Deuteronomy 29 and verses 24 through 28. And this is additional promises that God makes about their the conditions surrounding possession of the land. Verse 24, and after they have become apostate and not been faithful to the Lord, then this happens. Verse 24, all nations would say, why has the Lord done so to this land? What does the heat of the great anger mean? Verse 25, then people would say, because they have forsaken the covenant of the Lord God of their fathers, which he has made with them when he brought them out of the land of Egypt, where they went and served other gods and worshipped them, gods that they did not know and that they had not given to him. Then the anger of the Lord was aroused against this land to bring on it every curse that is written in this book. And the Lord uprooted them from their land in anger and wrath and great indignation and cast them into another land as it is this day. So, what God is saying here is this. If you're not faithful, if you don't obey the commands, then your right to inherit the land and to possess it is going to be taken away from you. And that's something that is therefore a condition that is placed on their being in the land of Israel. Now, in addition to these passages, we can turn over to the New Testament and look at what Jesus has to say about the physical nation of Israel. Now notice Matthew chapter 23 and verses 37 through 38. Matthew chapter 23 and verses 37 through 38, because Jesus spoke about their future as well. In verses 37 and 38, here Jesus says, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, the one who kills the prophets and stones those who are sent to her. How often I wanted to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. See, your house is left to you desolate. Now this is a prophetic statement that Jesus made regarding the temple. And the idea was that because of their wickedness and because of their sin, because they rejected God's Messiah, that God was going to leave dwelling among them, that he was not going to live in the temple anymore. And therefore, their house, the temple, would remain to them desolate, that is empty, abandoned. And God would then give this nation up to another nation. Now, Jesus, in chapter 24, just a few verses later here, he says in verse 1, then Jesus went out and departed from the temple, and his disciples came to show him the buildings of the temple. And Jesus said to them, do you not see all these things? Assuredly I say to you, not one stone shall be left here upon another that shall not be thrown down. In other words, the temple was going to be destroyed, and it was not going to be any longer. The temple was going to be abandoned by God, and then it was going to be destroyed, and it was no longer going to remain for national Israel to use for worshiping. And so, Jesus' prophecies about the destruction of the temple also involve the promises that God made to the land. And again, these are conditional promises, and they are not given just unconditionally in perpetuity. For example, like the rainbow promise was given to Noah. Now that's an unconditional promise, and that's something that is going to be in perpetuity regardless of how people behave. But nevertheless, made to Abraham were conditional. Now, Jesus, in making this prophecy, we see that it was fulfilled in 70 AD when the Roman general Titus came into the city of Jerusalem and he completely destroyed it. And he tore down the temple. In fact, he was going to spare the temple, but the fires that were burning around the temple in that area were so hot that the gold on the temple melted down between the cracks of the rocks. And the Roman soldiers wanted that gold. And so they actually took levers and manipulated the stones so that they could get the gold that ran down between the rocks of the temple. Because that gold was part of their reward for conquering the city. So Jesus' prophecy came to fulfillment in a literal way. Not one stone was left upon another because those Roman soldiers wrenched them off so they could get the gold, and so that temple was not spared. Now, the intentions of the Romans for the city of Jerusalem was to have it made into a Roman colony. They did that for a while. They actually renamed it. Adrian renamed the city Aelia Capitolina, and they dedicated it to the Greek god Zeus. Well, the Jewish temple has not been rebuilt since that time. And Jesus' prophecy doesn't lead us to believe that God has any intentions to rebuild that temple anytime soon. Or, for that matter, to even restore the land of that area to the physical nation of Israel. The physical nation of Israel. All right. So, now that leads us to the next question, which is included in this question, which is this. Well, what about the political situation today in regard to Israel? The land, the nation of Israel has settled today that we see was given to them by the United Nations in, I think it was 1948 that it was given to them. And it was given to them in, or as reparations for the Holocaust because of what Hitler did to all so many Jews in the nation of Germany. And so, because of that, the land that we know as the land of Palestine and the land of Canaan now belongs to a nation, and that nation is named Israel. And it was for the, quote-unquote, the Jews who were living in Europe to settle into that land after the Second World War. And Harry Truman was involved in that decision. And that was one of his big things that he wanted to get done. Now, a lot of people have looked at that and said, aha, God is restoring the nation, the land of Israel to the Jews. But is that really what is taking place? Just because there is a political decision made doesn't necessarily mean that God is the one who initiated that political decision. You know, there's been political decisions made in our country. For example, the Supreme Court, back in 1972, decided that abortion was legal. Well, just because it's made a political decision, does that mean that God approves of it or supports it? Of course not. More recently, there was a political decision made by the Supreme Court that homosexuality would be allowed to have marriages. Does that mean that God approves of homosexual marriages? Of course not. Well, just the same, just because the United Nations voted to give land to the people known as the Jews after the Second World War does not mean that God approves of that decision. Now, there's another wrinkle that goes goes with this, which as I was studying this particular question, I discovered. And there is a book written by a man who claims to be, who evidently is a Jew, and he wrote a book, The Invention of the Jewish People. And his name is Shlomo Sand, and he works at, and he's a professor at, evidently, Tel Aviv University, all right, which is, or used to be, the capital of Israel, in modern-day Israel today. And he argues in this book that modern Jews do not descend from ancient Israelites. That they do not descend. That there's no relationship between them. But that they come from other groups who took on Jewish identities primarily in the Middle Ages. Now, that accords with what we know from the time of the first century, in that all the genealogical records that were kept in the temple were destroyed by the Roman army. And so that implies that there's no evidence, no genealogical evidence, to tie any one group of people today who call themselves Jews to the ancient Israelites. And is that significant? Well, it's significant in the sense that there's no biblical reason to believe that God restored the land of Israel to its quote-unquote rightful owners. Nor do we have any genealogical reason to believe that today's owners are the quote-unquote rightful owners in a biblical sense. All right, so where does that leave us then? Well, no one is doubting that the modern-day nation of Israel is not a good ally to us in the region, that is to the United States. Certainly, they're a good ally in that regard, and that's fine. And I don't think that anyone, I personally don't have a problem with the United Nations granting that land to the group of people that were persecuted and many of them murdered by Hitler in the 1930s and 40s as reparations for how they were treated. I don't have a problem with that. That's fine. That's a political decision. The world can make political decisions like that all day long, and that's fine. But it doesn't necessarily mean that God is behind it, and that's what I'm trying to get at in this question. The question just said, who is the rightful owner of the state of Israel? And the answer, there's only really one answer to that question. God is the owner. But has he given it to modern-day Israel? And the answer is, I don't believe he has. I don't believe there's any reason to think that he has from the Bible. And whether it's been given politically today or not is irrelevant to what God thinks. So, now, another question that arises in this regard is, where does the great religious fervor for Jews inhabiting the land of Israel originate? That is, why are there so many people today in the religious world who seem so gung-ho on the Jews, the modern-day Jews, inhabiting the land of Israel? Well, it comes from the religious doctrine of premillennialism, in large part. And premillennialism is a series of teachings that have at their core the idea that when Jesus returns, he is going to come back to the earth and he's going to establish a literal throne in the literal city of Jerusalem, and he's going to reign on that throne for 1,000 years in the city of Jerusalem. He's going to reign over the whole world from the city of Jerusalem. And so, I don't believe that doctrine. The Bible does not teach that doctrine. That is another discussion. And we can have that discussion sometime. And it's an interesting discussion. But the point that I'm making is that those who do believe that have a stake in Israel inhabiting Jesus over all the earth. That's why they're so gung-ho for that. That's why they think that that's a good thing, those who support all of this. And when the United Nations gave them that land in 1948, many looked at that as a quote-unquote a sign. Oh, it's about time for Jesus Christ to come back, because, they say, Israel has been restored to their land. And that's a quote-unquote sign for them. Well, that is not what the Bible teaches about the second coming of Christ. In fact, it's the opposite. The Bible says there's not going to be any sign. Jesus is going to come as a thief in the night, and there's not going to be any warnings about it. And so that is mistaken on their part. Another one of the tenets of the doctrine of premillennialism is this, that God never fulfilled his promise to Abraham. And so therefore, it needs to be fulfilled today still. And that's why Israel is in, or the Jews are in the land of Canaan or Palestine today. So they look at Genesis 15, verse 18, which says, to Abraham, to your descendants, I give this land from the river of Egypt to the great river, the river Euphrates. All of that God promised to Israel. Well, did God fulfill his promise? That's the question then. And the fact is that God did fulfill that promise in 1 Kings chapter 4, in verses 20 and 21, under the reign of Solomon. It says, Judah and Israel were numerous as the sand by the sea in multitude, eating and drinking and rejoicing. So Solomon reigned over all kingdoms from the river, that is the Euphrates River, to the land of the Philistines, as far as the border of Egypt. So you see, there is the promise fulfilled in the time of Solomon. So there's the idea that God has yet to fulfill the land promised to Abraham is not correct. And he has fulfilled that promise. Now, in addition to all of this information, we want to make one more additional point from the scriptures. There is prophecy in Jeremiah 31, verses 31 through 34, about the coming of a time in which God would change the covenants. This is from Jeremiah. It says, behold, the days are coming, says the Lord, when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel, with the house of Judah, not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to lead them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant which they broke, though I was a husband to them, says the Lord. But this is the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, says the Lord. I will put my law in their minds and write it on their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. No more shall every man teach his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord. For they all shall know me, from the least of them to the greatest of them, says the Lord. For I will forgive their iniquity, and their sin I will remember no more. So the covenant that God is going to make, from Jeremiah's perspective, is that it's going to be a covenant that is in reference to their minds and their hearts. It's not going to be a physical covenant that involves land and people and in the sense of geographically confined people, so to speak. It's not going to involve that. Instead, it's going to be a covenant of anyone who is willing to give their mind and their heart to the Lord. And what's the sign of this covenant? I will forgive their iniquity and their sin, and I will remember no more. Well, we see that fulfilled in the person of Jesus. When he died on the cross, he shed his blood for the forgiveness of sins and thereby established the new covenant. And so we're no longer under the old covenant, but we're under the new covenant. The old covenant has been abolished and made obsolete, according to Ephesians 2, verse 15, Galatians 4, 21 to 31, and Hebrews 8, and verse 13. And all people now, both Jews and Gentiles, live under the new covenant of Christ and are amenable to the new covenant of Christ for salvation. Romans chapter 1, verses 16 and 17. The Apostle Paul writes, "But I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek." And then he says, "For therein the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, even as it is written, the righteous shall live by faith." So it's in the gospel message today where we find salvation, not in the old covenant. And because of that, there is no more connection between Jews and the land of Palestine, or the land of Israel, in the Bible. And so, the nation of Israel today has no more greater spiritual significance than the United States. The nation of Israel today has no more greater spiritual significance than the nation of Panama, or the nation of Korea, or the nation of Russia, or any other nation on the face of the earth. They're the same, they're equal, and there's no special place biblically for the physical nation of Israel anymore. God's people today are not the Jewish people per se, although some of them may be God's people by virtue of their being Christians. God's people today are simply those who have obeyed the gospel of Jesus Christ. And how do you do that? You hear Jesus' message, you believe it, you repent of your sins, you confess Him as Lord, and you're baptized for forgiveness of sins. And all those who have done that today, that's who God defines as Israel today. And we, spiritually speaking then, are part of the nation of Israel. Not those who live in Palestine, not those who live in a particular geographical location. None of that. It's a spiritual relationship now, not a physical one. Remember that Jesus said in John chapter 4 and verse 24, in answer to the question of the woman of the well, who said, "Where's the right place to worship? Is it here in Samaria or is it in Jerusalem?" And Jesus' answer was this: the time is coming in which there's not going to be a quote-unquote right place to worship anymore. Because why? Because those who worship God are going to worship Him in spirit and in truth. And then he says this: God is a spirit, and they who worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. And we can do that anywhere in the world. We don't have to have a temple in Jerusalem to do that. And that's the kind of relationship that we have with God today. All right, very good question. I'm glad it was asked, and we have a lot. There's a lot of things to say about it. And I could have. There are even more things to say about it than what I said, believe it or not. but I know that that was kind of a long question. But nevertheless, there's some good accompanying questions that go with it. Well, tonight, if there's anyone who would like to respond to the message of the gospel and become a child of God, then we're ready to help you today. You can be part of the nation of Israel today. The spiritual nation of Israel. Because that's what Christians are today. We don't need a land to be the spiritual nation of Israel. And so this evening, if you want to do that, we're ready to help you. If you need prayers at the church this evening, for whatever reason, you can also make that request known. And you can do so now, while together we stand, and while we sing the song of invitation.
Let's Heavenly Father, we continue our thanks now for this cup of fruit of the vine, which represents your Son's blood that was shed on the cross. We ask that you be with the ones that partake of this cup, that will do so in a manner pleasing unto thee.
Thank you.
shall be praising Jesus and his love. He is everything to me. He is everything to me, and everything shall always be. I will never cease to praise. A song of gladness is praise. Here and there in the world above, my soul shall sing, the Savior's love. Life and love and joy is He, the precious, precious good for me.
Congratulations.